This is the Success Happy Hour Experience with the Drunken Grape. I have a success guru here. What is success and how do you fire that up in your life? We're going to get into it. We're going to talk about processes of success by Bryan McDonald of onPurpose Growth, as well as his model, getting more specific towards the end of the show, talking about sales and revenue generation. He is an expert in all things business and revenue growth. He is a strategic wizard, has an extensive background into it. As always, before we get into the show itself, make sure to subscribe to the channel, share the content, like this show, comment on the show. All these things help the algorithm of YouTube. It's a tricky beast to navigate. So we do invite you to do exactly that. Without further delay, Bryan, welcome to the show. How are you doing, my friend? This is a long time coming.
Yeah, I'm doing awesome, man. I appreciate the invite. I'm excited to be here and excited to be part of the Drunken Grape.
Awesome. So as we get into it and we get closer to the part of the happy hour toast, let's first get into what is the general parameters for success and, you know, what systems should people generally look to have in place and why is it hard to obtain for a lot of people? Because, you know, if it was easy, as Scotty Schindler says, and we all know Scotty Schindler from System 1357, everybody would be doing it.
Yeah, because even though we think we know what the answer is, it's typically a couple steps away from where we start, right? So I think the number one thing, I have a client that asks me pretty frequently. He's got an engineering background. He does continuous improvement consulting, Lean Six Sigma consulting, and
oh, cool.
And every so often he asks me, he goes, Bryan, why am I making it? And a bunch of my peers who I worked at, Motorola, these big companies with, who are trying to be consultants, they don't. And I said to him, Matt, because you are willing to work on yourself as much as you're willing to work on your business. Because I have a big belief that success, entrepreneurship, is about who you are becoming. And if you never change and adapt, your business never changes and adapts.
Yeah, I mean, that's really profound and it's true because it's like an iceberg. Everybody sees the front of it or the top of it. They don't see the 95%. There's a great graphic that actually talks about that. I posted it once on LinkedIn. I actually gained a ton of traction in my early days, had tens of thousands of views because it had meaning. Wow. It's like not one of these engagement pod spam posts, but an actual purposeful post. And it talks about, you know, how everyone sees at the top of the pyramid, this little pyramid at the top, how everyone sees the success. They see the nice house. They see that you're gone on vacation a lot. They see that you're not stressed. They see that you don't want for anything. I mean, there, yep. From that point, there's varying degrees, right? I mean, do you really need a private island and a Learjet? No, you don't.
No.
But you certainly need your freedom. And these people have obtained that. It's kind of like Charles Maslow's theory of needs, right? Self-actualization. But below it, the graphic was awesome because it talked about the rough, endless nights, sleepless nights, 16-hour days sometimes, not being able to attend some key functions in life, the sacrifices financially and emotionally and physically they had to take. Looking at the staircase, and it shows like this broken staircase that kind of goes like this. It almost reminds me of what I call the yo-yo up the staircase. Eventually you get there, but it hits a lot of peaks and valleys on its way. And that is really the secret to it. I mean, it's a grind. And you nail something that's critical and something I've always believed in. You know, if things are sputtering on the outside of your business or outside of your career, whatever endeavor you're looking at, academic endeavor, you could be working on your PhD or a doctorate or becoming a doctor itself or, you know, your law degree. It is important to constantly evolve yourself.
Mm-hmm. I mean, it's key because think about, you know, any business, it doesn't look the same way it does today than when it started. They never do, Right.
They don't.
There's always, I mean, growth equals change, right? I mean, it's, you can't have growth without change. Because growing means I'm here and I'm going to be here, right? And this is different than this. So, realizing that and buying into it, and understanding that I love that you said, you know, they never paint the picture of what actually happens, only the destination, right? Nobody tells you, or very few tell you about, the things that happen late at night. Speaking of Scotty, right? Like, I was talking to Scotty once and he was telling me there were times where he was up all night long fixing code in the technology that he had because he I don't know if he couldn't afford it to pay somebody or he just didn't have a resource to fix it, where, you know, he was out selling during the day and at night he was fixing the code because it needed to work in the morning. And many, you know, many people either don't hear those stories, even though they're shared, or those stories just aren't shared.
Yeah. Or they don't hear the fact that somebody has to work two or three jobs to make that business happen too. Like, they're out there hustling in the daytime to make things happen in their evenings, their spare time at night to drive it. And it's, I mean, everything, I believe it's like athletics, you know, I was involved in athletics. Everything has a tipping point or a breaking point. It's like, if you're trying to lift more or run further, throw that football harder, or be more accurate, basketball hoops, or kick a soccer ball better, which is to the Europeans out there, football. But, you know, it's, there's a wall that people hit. And if you keep whacking the wall, eventually the wall chips away and breaks. And most people quit before they break the wall. They fail to realize they're actually knocking pieces of the wall off as they hit it. You know, totally. In your coaching, you come across this, don't you?
Oh, you know, all the time. I've learned, Rob, actually, when clients come on board or they're deciding to come on board, I always disclose, like, hey, this isn't going to be easy. Like, I'm not going to beat around the bush. There's times that this is going to be hard, right? Are you okay with that, right? Because I'd rather have somebody stop right then and there than stop in the middle of it, because that's what breaks my heart, is seeing people so close to seeing them chip away at it when they don't, and then they stop. Like, no, you were right there. You were right there. So I definitely see it, you know, all the time. And I'm a no surprises, no BS kind of person. I'd rather sell the hard right in the beginning than sell the warm and fuzzy end.
You know, and on that note, it's so true. Let's toast to that. And happy hour, ladies and gentlemen. I know you got some bourbon here. I have a West Mall Trappist Triple Ale. Belgium. This is monk beer. There's one of 13 active monasteries on the globe. West Mall is one of the largest and most prolific. Monks been brewing beer since, before the Middle Ages. And the Trappist order comes from the Benedictines into the Cistercians. A lot of it was because they were disposed during the terror and the reign of Napoleon. And then afterwards, they came back as the Trappist order, and they adhered to strict adherence. So all the proceeds of these beer sales go to supporting the monasteries of which they're brewed in. And it has to be, in order to be a Trappist beer, it has to be brewed within the walls of the monastery itself. I know a lot of the listeners have seen these beers pop up. They're some of my favorite. And as we're rolling into fall, you know, Thanksgiving's around the corner in Canada. Thanksgiving's coming up pretty quickly in the States, that third Thursday. Is it the third Thursday or fourth Thursday? Third Thursday in November with the NFL football games. This one is really rich. You're looking at about 9% alcohol. It's about 10 when it's finally in the glass, because it also goes through a fermentation and bottle, like champagne.
Really?
Yeah, they add pitch some brewer's yeast and sugar inside this, and it continues to ferment. What it does is it also adds a lot of sparkle and carbonation to it too. So wonderfully dry, acidic. These beers cut into a lot of cheese dishes. It goes well with strong cheeses. You know, typical nutmeg, you know, baking spice, bit of brown sugar. Tastes a bit like a rum cake when you sip on these things.
Those are great. I love those Trappist beers. They're phenomenal.
Oh, yeah. I love the spicy nutmeg notes.
Is it 9% on the bottle, but then 10%
on the bottle? So it's 9.5% on the bottle. So it's probably more like 10.5, almost 11 by the time you get it in the glass. These are boozy. Do not operate motor vehicles ever after having one of these. It's the equivalent of chugging three beers in one sitting. I mean, yeah. It's alcohol levels and percentages go in a cascading effect. So if you think about it, a 5% beer is weighted at about a shot of 1.25 ounce. And then, or I believe 1.5 ounces of spirits. It's the equivalent of 5 ounces of wine. But you're looking at something that's double the alcohol count of a regular beer at 5% in a glass.
Wow.
Yeah. Glad I'm not driving anywhere anytime soon. But what do you have there, my friend? You got bourbon. We're talking about that. Let's get into that. I love whiskey.
Oh, I got a little Buffalo Trace here. I was explaining before, my wife and I were visiting my mom with my kids and driving through Lexington. We stopped at the distillery and it was great. So I picked up a couple bottles because there's some places you can't get it around here in Chicago.
Well, yeah, and if you're in Lexington,
you get it, they sell out of it like that.
Right. Like, I mean, you're going to find Blanton's and Eagle Rare and 1792 and Woodford Reserve, all the classics. But all the craft stuff, yeah, make that road trip to Lexington. I was down there once for, of all things, an Amway convention back in 1994.
Oh, in Lexington?
In Lexington, Kentucky. And I think at the time, was it the University of Kentucky had just won the NCAA championship on top of that. Ooh. So it was nuts.
Oh, man, that was but probably a great time.
Even in the winter, I remember driving by and you see these large old wooden buildings and then all these distilleries are just dotted everywhere. Yeah, and it's cool, right? Because bourbon's rich. I mean, bourbon's 51% corn mash or more in the maize. It's a sour mash of like a sour mash beer. It's beer minus the hops. It's fermented, then it's distilled. It's brought up to depending on the strength you want it at, initially 63 to 95 96%, sometimes 98%, in the high 90s anyway. Second distillation, you're looking at about 63, 64. Then it gets quite a bit higher on the third distillation. It's at that point, it's almost all booze. And the runoff of any kind of water or whatever's left is evaporated. But it depends what you want to do. If you want to have a spirit that's more natural and raw with a bit more flavor, you usually go a double distillation like scotch. Bourbon, old or brand new American white oak. And you get a lot of nutty notes in it. As it gets a lot older, it resonates a bit, but you get a lot of vanilla and coconut on the palate with these things as well. So, I mean, American white oak does a lot of great things in the world of wine too. Rioja, for instance, uses American white oak in Spain, and things like dill pop up in the flavor notes. So it's pretty interesting how the cooperage sites work and how barreling affects a lot of things. If you get the scotch, you get into old oak that's used, old bourbon barrels. This is what a spirit looks like if it's unaged. This is not whiskey technically, because whiskey has to be at least 3 years old, but this is Irish. This is what it looks like, not barreled. It's a clear
liquid. Irish whiskey?
This is Irish. This is an Irish spirit. This is actually a craft spirit from Canada. This is right around my city of Ottawa. My brother bought this for me for my 50th birthday. I still have this. It's quite awesome stuff, but that's what it looks like. No, God, no. So no, not at all. So it's a lot more raw and a lot more herbal. It's quite potent. I just throw a little bit in here. I'm going to take a little touch of distilled water. This is bottled water in this little jar. A little bit of water helps open up a lot of those flavor notes in booze. You don't want to put too much in there. You just want to lift it out a little bit. Very herbal. Yeah, it doesn't have those raisinated vanilla, nutty notes, caramel, toasted notes in it at all, because that comes with cask age. And like you were mentioning in the green room, spirits age. What happens is the volume in the cask diminishes greatly over time. You lose about 2% a year. It's called the angel share. And what happens is it micro-oxygenates in those barrels. So it starts to amber and eventually gets dark brown over time when you've got a really old spirit. Plus the headspace in the cask grows, right? So in the beginning, there's no headspace. And as it evaporates out of the cask over time, it kind of goes like this down the cask. And all this is extra air oxygenating the spirit as well and attacking it. So this is how you create aged spirits. And I mean, these things last indefinitely. Great drinks to have. Come on, you know, fall. Reach out for those stouts as well. So getting back to success, On purpose growth. Talk to us a bit about that. What got you motivated to start it? Because you know what? You're on your own entrepreneurial journey like I am with the Drunken Grape, and it's not easy. You know, folks, for all of you tuning in, we are here to support you. Success, having discussions around success, positive mindset, it helps you get rid of that imposter syndrome.
Oh, totally. Right. And it goes right to what I was saying earlier is the way you get rid of the imposter syndrome is you work on yourself, you develop yourself, because imposter syndrome is just a narrative or a voice people hear in their head. It's not actually true. Right. Like, and for anybody out there saying, well, I'm not successful yet, I can guarantee, I'm not going to, oh, well, I'll guarantee you, and that's not really what I was trying to say, but I have clients who are millionaires, making over $1 million a year, and they still are afflicted with that. So it's not the amount of money that matters, that mindset. What matters is you working on that mindset. So, you know, that's one of the reasons why the mindset and the imposter syndrome is one of the reasons why I started On Purpose Growth with my partners, because I realized that I could do for myself what I was doing for other people. And why make somebody else rich, you know, generating sales for them? Why not, you know, just go do it for myself? And, you know, what it took was, I used to spend a lot of time with my referral network of them asking me like, hey, you talk about sales in this way, explain that to me. I like your approach or philosophy. And, you know, I was doing lots of happy hours, lunches, breakfasts. And finally, somebody asked me, a guy who was a banker, his name was Eric. He said, hey, I want to go be a financial advisor in that space. I want you to help me, and I'll pay you to meet with me and teach me everything that you know. And in 6 months after he made that jump, he was top three in every metric his company made.
I believe it. You know, I've been resistant to the whole coaching carousel thing. And quite honestly, I'm now realizing it's a good thing to probably pick up, because they hold you accountable. It gives you goal lines. Totally. They give you a goal line that you've got to score on, and it's a tangible thing now, because you now know you have a set date and a target date that you better deliver on something.
Yep.
And that holds you down. It's not for everybody, the weak of spirit. I mean, listen, if you think you're going to be handheld and everyone wins a prize mentality, this is not the arena to be in. And real coaches are tough. Real coaches grind you. They get on you. They do it in a positive and affable way, but they're like, hey, listen, you know, we got things to do. We got deadlines to achieve. It's like a good manager in the battlefield of a workplace will do that, or a good boss or a good owner, you know, and it's true. I think for everyone tuning in, this is really, really critical. I mean, you must have seen some incredible successes with some of the people you've worked with.
Oh, that 3 weeks ago, you know, 2 weeks ago, I had a client who had, $100,000 cash and $10,000 in monthly recurring revenue in 1 week.
Wow.
Yeah. 1 week, right?
I'd like to know how they did that.
Man, he's grinding. And this is a guy who's not sales oriented, right? He sales does not naturally come to him. He's not outgoing like you and I are. He's a CFO. He's an outsourced CFO. And, you know, he's on path to make $1 million in his first year of existence. Right. So,
crazy.
One of the reasons why we decided to partner together, because I realized, and he stated it, that he was willing to just get out of his own way and work on himself and be open. I told him like, hey, I don't have all the answers. What I do have is the ability to notice what's happening, ask you good questions, and help you start getting your answers. And he just, you know, digs in and is all in on himself, and removes the imposter syndrome, removes the stories he tells himself that don't help him, and replaces them with new ones. And for sales, he's very client centric, right? He wants to make an impact on the people he works with. He doesn't want transactions. He wants impact. And that's what's helping him sell fast. He's very client-centric, because there's people in the world that say, yeah, I'm client-centric, but when you show up and their actions don't meet their words, with this guy, their actions meet his words. And people appreciate that. So I've seen, you know, story after story like that, right? When I meet and partner with the right people, it happens like clockwork.
You know, you nailed three things there that are really critical. Getting out of your own way is the one that really stands tall. Not being transactional, the next one. These are things I preach to people, and relationship building. And you know what? Build quality. It's better to slowly sell and build, building with integrity and quality along the way, than it is to try to scoop dollars where it's questionable as to what that final delivery is going to be. And it's like the old days of cold calling. You remember that? Picking up the phones, pounding the pavement. Could you think of a more transactional way of trying to do things than cold calling?
Oh, no. That's it, right? That's the epitome of it, right? That's the epitome of it. It's there might as well be mutual definitions in a dictionary.
Oh, yeah. I met the guy who wrote the book Cold Calling, Cold Calling is Dead, back in the early 2000s. I'm trying to remember his name. On cruise ships. Oh, yeah. I used to work in the cruise line industry, and he literally came on board as we're going from New York to Bermuda. He was a cool guy. Yeah. He was partying with a crew on the beach with all of us, and I'm like, you wrote that book. I'm trying to remember his name, but back then—
I know the book too. I forget what it is.
Yeah. I just came out of working at a telecom company for 2 years. It was Telus Mobility. And they made us do the DEI cold calling sales course and all this stuff. And I told him, but he goes, oh, man, that's that Jewish guy that's a legend and supposed legend in selling. He goes, no, he's just a legend in selling that course. He goes, you know, the ledges and the counter comments. And he said, listen, do you think really any of that ever really worked? And I'm like, no. Because companies was the cheapest way for them to reach out. Heaven forbid they had to invest in you to get out and network and really join business associations, get up and present, talk to groups, do a TV spot or two, get on the radio, things that make sense now that they sort of worked against then. And he was talking about all this stuff then. He's like, you know, cold call. And on my way out of that telecom company, one of the main bosses pulled me aside and he goes, yeah, you're hitting your targets. I don't blame you for going back to see. At that point, they had managers selling against us. They put them on a sales quota. So the guy that you're reporting to was poaching your accounts. Oh, yeah, I walked out. So, yeah, fuck that. You know, I walked right out of that place. And they didn't understand that the transactional nature of cold calling was also killing them, because you were constantly battling for your client. Even once you got them, you had no relationship and they had no loyalty. All they saw was price. Everything became price and bottom line.
Commodity. You're a commodity.
You just commoditized yourself.
I work with a handful of EOS implementers at all times, and there's a saying in that organization: if you drag your client in, you're going to have to drag them out. Because, and I see that same way with cold calling. It's like you're going to set up a commoditization. You're going to get beaten up on price, and then it's going to suck because you're going to complain. Hey, all they want to do is talk about price. They never see my value.
Absolutely. I mean, it makes me drink thinking about this, but you know, but it's just, but it's crazy. It's just the whole commoditization of, I had a call recently from someone I know that asked me for my services, and I would have had to travel a couple hours from Ottawa by car to go up there. Probably had to get a room for the night. And I quoted them a reasonable price. And I said, listen, I know you, but this is my fee. And they're like, what? You're charging what to present and what? And I said, well, here, let's go back to what it is now. I said, how many people can go live and present really well? I said, you can automatically eliminate most people. How many people on top of that in my field can get up and talk knowledgeably about wine and spirits and host a whole wine and cheese party for an hour and a half for you and make sense of it? Okay, so we've eliminated another whole pool of people. How many years do you think it took for me to do all the branding and building of this to get into generating revenue properly when I do host things? And what would I say to the people that I build that rate to that had paid it happily and then were very happy with the service deliverable? What would happen if they found out I gave you some fat discount?
Yep.
And it was all of a sudden she calls back. Oh, yeah, no, we found a girl locally. It's well beyond what the guy wanted to pay for his 60th birthday. Meanwhile, they live in one of the richest neighborhoods in Montreal and they have all kinds of money. I had to laugh at this. And again, just went after a transaction, picked up some local girl for maybe $300 in the area. And all I said to her is, I said, well, I hope it goes well. And I meant that. And really, in the end, it doesn't go well because it's a whole different presentation and a persona. She'll just sit over there and go, well, these notes go with this because, and just give the general parameters maybe of wine tasting, but there'll be no flow and structure to it. Yeah. I guarantee what I like to pump out is things like an engagement guide. It outlines the whole thing, all the activity going into it. The tasting notes are already in your hand by the time all this starts. So you've prepped the people, and then you prep them for the basics. Okay, well, you're going to need these glasses. You need to have this, have some water with you, have some light bread or crackers to refresh the palate between courses. Mm-hmm. And just all the nuances of this. Now, there's a reason you're getting that. And I was thinking about it because I also attended a wedding not too long ago that was, you know, honest God, it was not the greatest wedding in the sense that it was just, I love the guy hosting it. Well, he's a great friend, but it was, the wedding had a lot of hiccups. And you pay what you get for, you know, you pay for what you get. And if you look at things transactionally, it'll never work out for you.
Mm-hmm.
In anything.
You may win in the short term. It may seem that you're winning in the short term, but the long term, it never works out. It never, ever works out. I've got a general philosophy, mindset, principle, I don't know what to call it, but like when somebody approaches me and either the first or the second question is, hey, what's your price? I immediately know that it's a dead deal. They're never gonna work with me.
Yeah, actually, what's your price? It's true. They're never gonna work with me either. I end up just saying go to a restaurant and have that sommelier host it for you then if you're gonna do that.
Totally.
And then they fail to realize it's $150-$200 a plate anyway. I mean, when they get in there, they think they're saving and then they get clobbered.
Well, one thing I want to point out to everybody in your story, that there's a very big distinction between you and this girl, right? You were providing an experience. She was providing a talk that was most likely dry. They are two completely different things.
Yeah, and you pay what you – I mean, would you want it a keynote anniversary or birthday party or workplace celebration of milestones and achievement tarnished because you were counting the pennies on the table and not the dollars and the experience flubbed? Like going back to the wedding, I mean, you have a wedding. Make sure that experience is great for people. Even if you have to do a small wedding, make it a great experience. Mm-hmm. You want to do things that people rave about for years to come. And this all ties into success, doesn't it?
Oh, my gosh. I mean, I'll talk about in sales. Customers and prospects and clients don't care about what you say. They care about how you make them feel. And success is about having a large number of people feel fulfilled or happy or satisfied with what you provide them. Like for instance, there's I have a handful of clients who are on month-to-month contracts. They make a decision every single month to renew
or cut.
And there's been three people that have been around for about 5 years.
They've never cut.
They can leave at any time. They can leave at any time, right? And I think that says something that when somebody has a choice every single month, their experience is great. I mean, I verify it too, right? But there's an implied their experience is great, and that success. If people are choosing consistently to stay with you, that's a sign of success, right?
That 100%.
Little effort and energy to get a high return.
Yeah. I mean, I was brought in to help a good friend of mine. I gave him a deal because he's awesome to everybody. I mean, this is a bit of a give back because he's an awesome restaurant owner. He owns Mezzanotte in Ottawa, the Italian bistro. His name's Tony. He's ran that place for 28 years. He's around 50 now. He gives a shit about everything. Like, he has staff that have been here since he opened. What does that tell you about the restaurant business of how he does things? So I come in and he calls me up and says, hey, you know, I know it's short notice. Can I get you in here? They want Ernst & Young has 120 people come to my restaurant, plated, you know, dinner. And they want it's a 3-course meal. They want wine. They want a wine talk with it. I go, you want me to host the whole thing? I go, yeah, we'll do that. And you know what? He had no problems paying the billable I presented, because, you know, you can chop it down a little bit if you're not doing all the sales process and it just lands on your lap like that. And you just have to show up and make some recommendations. It still takes a few hours to plan and execute, but you deliver it. And his attitude was, Rob, it's never, money won't be the question. He goes, you're just, that experience was awesome. He goes, I know there are accountants and a lot of them aren't into it. They just, but the people who were, the 20 or 30 people that really engaged in it, loved it and raved about it. And I guarantee the next time that lady does a company event like that, she's going to be looking at for my mirror image, if I'm not around, or me, just to host that, because you bring the whole experience to life. You engage them. And the experience, as you mentioned, is the biggest cornerstone to driving a service or a product. It's the number one thing. Why does PlayStation do so well? Because the experience of gaming on it is so fun. You know, probably even greater than the Xbox experience, because it's also Sony just knows how to integrate that whole experience just one step better. The iPhone, why is it still dominant, absolutely dominant in all revenue dollars in the handheld space around the world? Because the experience of the iPhone is second to none. Yeah, and guess what? It is also by far the most expensive experience.
Totally.
So kind of that eliminates your theory on price right there. And I agree with you. People, if somebody leads off and asks you what your price is right off the get-go in the beginning, do not be interested in them. It's, you know, walk away. If they tell you what their budget is, that's a different story, because now they're actually giving an honest parameter of what they can work with. They tell you they got $2,000. Don't be shy to max out the $2,000, but deliver on it. So yeah, we can do $2,000. No problem. This is what we're going to do for $2,000. Or $5,000 or whatever it is. You can work with that, but you cannot work with somebody who goes, what's your price? Because you know what they're going to do? They're going to pick up that phone 28 times until they find the cheapest person. And shame on all those being hosted by that person, because it's going to be a horrible, shitty experience. I guarantee it.
Yeah. Yep. Somebody just battling on price isn't there to serve. It's just there to do a transaction. And that's the experience you're going to get, right? And most people don't expect a transaction. They expect an experience, yet they buy a transaction, right? That's where buyers, the psychology of a buyer, they play games that don't work for them, even though they think they work.
Yeah. And you know, again, you're nailing on something. Do you want somebody hosting something or doing something for you on any credible level? You want somebody doing your taxes or your legal work that's looking for a quick transaction or pest control or whatever it might be? You don't. You want somebody who's going to execute and get that job done brilliantly. That's what you want.
100%, right? What you're buying is a means to an end of something, and realize that, right? Realize that I tell clients all the time or I'll tell anybody, the people don't buy the thing that you sell. They buy the help that they need, right? So your buddy who had the Ernst & Young, right? He needed to give those people a great experience so he could, because he wanted to look good or, you know, something in that direction, right? So he wasn't buying your knowledge and wisdom. He was buying your ability to make him look good and give those people a great experience.
Absolutely. And, you know, and he could have gone the other way if some asshats I know in the small business community of Ottawa that turn around, they offer you vouchers to the restaurant if you do something. Well, I'll give you $5,000 worth of food coupons. Well, first of all, food costs is what, 29 to 32 cents on the dollar? So that's all you're really getting. You're not getting $5,000. You're getting 32 cents of five. You're getting 32% of $5,000. You know your numbers. Know your basic math when you're billing. Know this when you're actually out selling and soliciting. And just because somebody has a wallet, some of them are the worst people to deal with individually because they're just trying to squeeze you for their own benefit and their own transactional pleasure. Go after somebody who actually has genuine intent. I love what you said. You know, time is precious. You know, we're going to end on this thought. It's been a delightful talk with you, but time is so precious that when somebody leads with price, I love how you say, cut that conversation right away. Don't be shy to say, well, I'm probably not the person for you, right on the phone. Eliminate them from ever calling back.
Exactly.
It's because not that worth person's it. Never going to have the intent to work with you.
No,
they raised a really big sign that said, hey, I'm going to be transactional. That's all I'm going to be. And all we're going to do is talk about price. I don't care what you do and how you do it.
True, man. Listen, you've been a fantastic guest. How do people get a hold of you? What's the best way? LinkedIn, you're really prolific on. I love your posts. I love the information you share. Ladies and gentlemen, follow Bryan McDonald on LinkedIn. He gives a lot of excellent insights and tidbits, literally 3 to 4 times a week. I think you post regular, good quality, one-page information. Yeah. Is there anywhere else that they can find you?
Yeah, probably the best place is, two places is onpurposegrowth.com or my website, mcdonaldbryan.com. It's my last name, first name, Bryan with a Y. That McDonald Bryan will always be pointed to the best place to get a hold of me through time. So, those are the two best ways. You can message me any of those places. And I'd love to hear from anybody that would found this conversation interesting.
Awesome. And ladies and gentlemen, make sure to tune into more episodes of the Success Happy Hour Experience. We delve in, I know it's been a bit of a break, but we delve in nearly weekly on these topics. We've got exciting guests always coming up, brilliant people, extraordinary people who've often also overcome great adversity to get there. I know Bryan works tirelessly. There's probably many years that you worked on a penny, on stretching that penny, and pretty much on sleepless nights and familial family pressure to get it done too. Listen, ladies and gentlemen, whatever you decide to do, have a terrific day. This is Rob and Bryan from The Drunken Grape.
Cheers.